earlier in the evening. I will talk about Cipher 9, which is part of the Better Block warehouse district promotion community thing over down by Delhi, Ohio on 3rd and Walnut. We have 2 hours to fill. We have 12 poets to fill. Skylark Bruce, our next feature, Andy, John Walters, Kristen Worsler, Derek Terrell, Zach Lee, who is here, Nick Ann, who is here. I am the, she helps, she runs things over at the local. Keely Aaliyah, one of our younger poets. Aria will be there. Ariana Iliff, I think she's from Akron. And I will close out the night with, you know, because reasons. So. Okay, so just letting you all know, we have flyers in the back if you all are interested in seeing those poets, and if you love Andy, you'll love everyone else too, so you should just...
And how do you not love Andy?
How can you not love Andy? Because...
unicorns.
As follows, unicorns, family, LGBT, love, Islam, America, Harry Potter, love, poetry, idealism, and Narnia. Please welcome Andy Lyon.
And Narnia.
Yes, thank you. We left out Narnia last time.
I think I have a quick question. How old is she?
How old are you?
9,000?
It's over!
I just had to like think about that before you, you know, started.
Oh my god, I love you guys so much. You're wonderful. You're one of my favorites. You just, like, your stuff is so powerful. And the last time I heard you was, like, way too long ago. Your book,
you know, the last time you heard me is the first time I met you?
No, that's false.
When?
I've seen you a few times. The first time you met me, you wrote me a poem, and it was on
the computer.
You
yell
a lot! I'm quiet
for that one.
And don't worry, I'm getting married in a couple months. And you, Mr. Neiman.
Hey.
I'm gonna get your free stuff, but I also want your CD because I need that shit in my car.
Yes. The one time I forgot my things is the one time somebody wants
it. And I got cash on me. I pulled cash
out. This would be like the only time in human history somebody would have bought my CD.
Happening.
I don't have it.
Oh, also, I have books. This is the second printing of my, and it's combined from two books to one, so you get part one and two, called Masha Allah. Buy me $6. I will also trade if you want, because I'd rather have your art than your money. But money's good, I'll take that too. Okay, so I like to start my sets with a poem that is not mine, usually because I'm jealous that I didn't write that poem, and I want to perform it anyway, and also to showcase other people that you may not get the chance to run into. So this is an old favorite of mine, and I got to meet this guy, and I did like pee my pants, or like make a fool out of myself, and all, I was very proud of myself. He's a slam poet from Atlanta by the name of Gabe Moses, and this poem is called How to Make Love to a Trans Person, and I had to do it on my phone because I couldn't access the website from work to print it. Okay. How to make love to a trans person. Forget the images you've learned to attach to words like cock and clit, chest and breast. Break those words open like a paramedic cracking ribs to pump blood through a failing heart. Put your hands inside. Get them messy. Scratch new definitions on the bones. Get rid of the old words altogether. Make up new words. Call it a clit or a ditto. Call it the sound he makes when you brush your hand against it through his jeans, when you can hear his heart knocking on the back of his teeth, and every cell in his body is breathing. Make the arch of her back a language. Name the hollows of each of her vertebrae when they catch pools of sweat, like rainwater in a row of paper cups. Align your teeth with this alphabet of her spine so every word is weighted with the salt of her. When you peel layers of clothing from his skin, do not act as though you are changing dressings on a trauma patient, even though it is highly likely that you are. Do not ask if she's have the surgery. Do not tell him that the needlepoint bruises on his thighs look like they hurt. If you are being offered a body that has already been laid upon an altar of surgical steel, a sacrifice to whatever gods govern bodies, they come with some assembly required, whatever you do. Do not say that the carefully sculpted landscape bordered by rocky ridges of scar tissue looks almost natural. If she offers you breastbone, aching to carve soft fruit from its branches, though there may be more tissue in the lining of her bra than the flesh that rises to meet it, let her ripen in your hands. Imagine if she'd lost those swells to cancer, diabetes, a car accident instead of an accident of genetics. Would you think of her as less of a woman then? Then think of her as no less a woman now. If he offers you a thumb-sized sprout of muscle reaching towards you when you kiss him, like it wants to go deep enough inside you to scratch his name on the bottom of your heart, hold it as if it can. In your hand, in your mouth, inside the nest of your pelvic bones, though his skin may hardly do more than brush yours, you will feel him deeper than you think. Realize that bodies are only a fraction of who we are. They're just oddly shaped vessels for hearts, and honestly, they can barely contain us. We strain at their seams with every breath we take. We are all pulse and sweat, tissue and nerve bending. We are programmed to grope and fumble until we get it right. Bodies have been learning each other forever. It's what bodies do. They are grab bags of parts, and half the fun is figuring out all the ways we can fit them together, all the different uses for hip bones and hands, tongues and teeth, all the ways to car crash our bodies beautiful. We can never forget how to use our hearts, even if we try. That's the important part. Don't worry about the bodies. They've got them. I worked as of 5 o'clock today. I no longer work at this place that is a call center, among other things. Not my department. We make phone calls for Donald Trump, Ben Carson, and the NRA. So at our big, like, comfy white meetings, I used to sit in the back of the room and wonder how many people in that room hated my Muslim transgender gay ass without even knowing it.
Speaking of that, Heather is watching now.
Oh, hi, Heather! I was totally joking about stealing Nick Ann. I love you, I'm still here.
I don't think she heard that part.
Okay, good.
But now she did.
Oh, shit! I told you to watch. Alright. So, oh no, I was gonna say, there's this trans woman there. Her name is Barbie. She's fabulous. And she sits on the other side of the room, and this lady was like, ugh. Like, one of the supervisors was like, I can't even stand to look over there. And I was like, I almost got fired. It's like, you did not. Anyway. So that was the last thing that happened to me before I left work. Gosh, I made notes and I can't even read them. So, in honor of not having a clean job anymore at this hellhole, I did write this poem about being a telemarketer, which, in case you've never had this experience, sucks out your soul for 8 hours a day, or 8 hours a week. So I wrote this poem called Getaway. I used to find all kinds of different ways to distract myself at work, and one of the first things that I did that was fun was I got on Google Maps, and like, you know how you can do like the street view? So I found all these crazy places like castles and mountains, and I toured the Vatican for my seat. There was this one castle in France where you could like walk around the castle and I could actually see the vendors on the street. It was wonderful. So anyway, I did that. This is called Getaway. Here as I sit at the keyboard, headset, auto dialer, by cable. It's 8 o'clock, time to make money. But at least we have employee appreciation days with blue jean privileges, donuts, and hot dogs. My body is here, but Google Earth has taken me to a beautiful walled city in France.
I spent hours following groups of tourists up and down the medieval stone streets, gazing at the swords and figurines of the street vendors. Today I roam Vatican City, visited castles in Austria and Wales, and Cathedral Notre Dame de Paris. But my tongue still moves on autopilot. May I please speak to the person who manages your phone and internet? Hang up, wrong number, cuss word, may I transfer you to their voicemail? I want to kick down these cubicle walls, get in my car, and drive until I can't sit any longer. I'm not longing to leave my life behind. This is no Reba McEntire song. I just need to get away to reassure myself that the world is bigger than my paycheck. The other thing I am celebrating is that 2 weeks something on the 5th I will have 5 years clean. All that stuff. So this I wrote actually before I got clean for real, for real. Sometimes it would happen and then unhappen and then happen again. But it was one of the times that I like managed to beat it for the night. And it's called Turnaround. It's past midnight. The concrete is slick. I am the only one on the sidewalk and everything smells like dirt and rain. Each step forward brings me 14. 28, 46 inches closer to death, but I cannot turn around. Out to Cleveland Avenue, down to 12th Street, over to Shore for my cop spot. I am vaguely stunned by my inability to stop walking. In my left hand, I hold my cell phone. My sponsor's number glows on the screen, but I seem just as incapable of calling as turning around and going home. Clenched in my right hand is an orange key. My trophy from 30 days of war with my addiction. It is the only thing reminding me which side of the fence I'm on. Crisp green dollars burn holes in my pockets just as sure as the lighter I used on my first cigarette. Each subsequent cigarette is lit on the end of the previous one. I swallow them whole, hoping they will satiate my craving instead of my fix. My brisk walk is a blur of smoke. I'm trampling straight through puddles and yelling at myself out loud for screwing up on purpose. I look at my feet and realize I'm just 5 blocks away. I'm crazed, almost running now. I can already taste my suicide. My trophy did not prepare me for this war. I know that if I get high again, I may never be able to quit. The first time is a miracle. The second time, blasphemy. The serenity prayer slips from my lips, the only coherent words I can manage. And with a strength that is not my own, I push the call button. But I do not turn around. I do not go home. My pace is erratic as I hear his phone ring. I pray that he will and hope that he will not answer. One step backward, trip, fall, 2 steps forward, heart pounding, hand shaking, mind careening. I hear his voice. Andrew, turn around. I can see it now. 1 block. I'm stopped still, paralyzed, staring at the most beautiful hell I have ever seen. Andrew, turn around. I'm silent. My drug of choice in my clean time play tug of war with my feet, but my mind is made up. I put 1 foot in front of the other, walk 14. 28, 46 inches toward life. So I was raised Christian and decided for like 30 seconds that I might want to be Catholic.
We don't hold it against you.
That did not work. What?
We don't hold it against you.
Yeah. Somehow I ended up in Islam. Okay, so this was during that 30 seconds when I decided I might want to be Catholic. is called Picking Something for Myself. I offered up my secrets in exchange for a bit of subversive backbone, sometime between homeschool corporal punishment and foster care. I spent a lifetime screaming at padded walls just to separate myself from you, and in the process, I kept nothing inside for myself. Perhaps it was this realization that kept me from telling you I went to Mass this morning. I pretended it was in indifference to your plea to please just give Jesus one more chance through adult eyes, not mixed up kid eyes. I can't imagine living with the conviction that my daughter's thick-skulled secular intellect would propel her into eternal torture. All I have to do to ease your desperation is tell you that I talked with Father Menelite, timid hand outstretched, offering the parish visitor's card like a confession, and that he promised to call so we could discuss my search. But I cannot find it within myself to assure you that I have been doing what you asked all along, afraid that your approval would jinx the unpacking of my religious baggage. In spite of you, I found my mystery again. It brushed my fingertips at the bottom of the bowl of holy water. It cushioned my knees as I knelt after communion. I can't bring myself to tell you that you were the reason I left in the first place, or that if the plea had come from anyone else, it is unlikely that I would have, felt sick on the church steps. My only comfort was in knowing that my return had nothing to do with it. Changing my order a little bit. Can I say shit? Look, he said fuck like five times.
He said fuck like a million times.
You shit.
You shit.
So this is my, so like the first time literally in years I have like all my published works in the same place and the one that is in process somewhere. I mean, I forgot what I was supposed to do next and Azra doesn't remember either. But this will be a book. It will be one of these days. Okay, and Zach is doing my art. I forget about you. I'm just like broke as hell here. But I will get you after this damn wedding thing. Okay.
Sounds good.
Those are really expensive. Don't do it. I love you. I'm
yeah,
sorry.
Well, she's not watching.
She's not watching?
No, she went to Kate Walmart to get carpet stuff.
Dog pooped like five times in her bedroom, so that's why she's not here. Okay, so this is called Psychosis. It's from the new thingy. The clouds are falling, and I hear the name calling, Andy, 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 press the pedal to the floor, hear the crash of metal in your mind, bring it to life, Andy, it's just wondering, how much more beautiful would this be if you were high? You wouldn't have to chase God's voice because everything would be a sign. And the clouds are falling, and I'm not who I am, and none of this is happening. And I hear the voices calling, Andy, they're drugging you. They don't want you to know the truth. Don't go to work. Don't take your pills. Don't be a slave. Andy, you are great, a god, a messenger, a savior, a slave. And the clouds are pressing on all sides. All the world is a diorama. I am a cardboard cutout. The sky is painted inside of a shoebox. And my brain is moving too fast. Internal car crash. Press the pedal to the floor. Andy, you know you miss the feeling of blood dripping down your arms. Andy, scream, fight, hit, flip tables. Andy, destroy. Don't keep it inside. I can't breathe this icy vapor. Clouds pressing in on all sides. My lungs crystallize. The clouds seep inside, nothing is real, breath is gone. Suffering is only necessary until I realize that it is not. And today, my eyes are frozen shut. I never know what I was supposed to do in Google class, so I just like look really busy looking for the next poem.
I feel it, I feel it.
I mean, I like it, but ego likes it. I just don't know what my body is supposed to be doing. Okay, so in order, so that's, I have bipolar 2 with psychosis, So that's like a real thing that happens on a regular basis, which is why I'm not working anymore. Thriving with that. Okay, so this is like my emotional after the episode has gone away, and then I feel guilty because I'm not strong enough to not be sick, because that's a thing. So this is the after effect, and then I will do the like spiritual realization after this one. Okay, so this is called unrealistic expectations. I'm sorry, I keep telling her, I'm sorry, as if I can control my brain chemistry, as if this oppressive depression is my own doing. When she asks me how I am for the sixth time that day, I tell her I don't know. I'm sorry, I'm so sad. I'm sorry I forgot to take my pills today, and it's too late to take them now. I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. Tears streak down my cheeks because I'm desperate for her to know that I love my life. I love our new house with its half-painted living room and our Great Dane puppy who shreds our toilet paper and compelled us to duct tape our trash can lid. I'm sorry because I loved my daughter, but I still cry when no one is looking. I'm sorry because I hate my job, but I tell myself I have no right to bitch when hers is nearing the point of termination. She tells me she just wants me to be happy, and a tear streaks down her own cheek. I'm sorry I made you cry, I say, but I want to scream that I just want me to be happy too. I love my life. I take my pills. I go to meetings and therapy, and still anxiety crushes me when I think of leaving the house. And still, I sit in the parking lot of my doctor's office, beating my steering wheel and screaming at God, I love my life. How can I feel so desperate when I love my life? I know, however, that whichever side of the fence I'm on today, whatever lies my brain is telling me today, I have a higher power. So I start there and follow the breadcrumbs back home.
Whatever.
What else?
Yep.
Okay.
Hi, Skylar! Hey! Hey, Skylar!
What?
I want a copy of that one, please.
Did you leave, like, right after I sent that text?
I didn't even get your text yet.
Okay.
Okay. Because I was driving, you know.
Right. Come on.
Okay. I knew what was happening. Alright. Whew. Breathing. Okay, this is called The Voice of Truth, and this is, like, the real, like, real with a capital R in the midst of all the mental illness stuff. Is this the right one? Oh, yes, okay. This is, like, way too close to me. The Voice of Truth. When the voices grab me, I slip away into a world the size of a shoebox. They tell me that I am on... No, wait, this is not the right poem. I didn't think that looked real. Hold up. I love me. I love you too. Why is there no table of content? That's why it's not published yet, I guess.
We'll get there.
In her eyes. In her eyes. Through her eyes. There we go. All right. Try that again. Through her eyes. After wondering and worrying and questioning, I was gently assured that I have grown more than I can see. The tree cannot see through its branches how close it is to the sky. It can only see how far it has come up from the ground, but often forgets to look down. Does a rose know it has bloomed, or does it just feel the sun? Does a river know it has flooded, or does it just feel the pool of the ocean, the growing current sweeping it toward the quencher of thirst? I feel truth closer than my skin, so close we are inside of each other, and I become him and he becomes me. I can taste the truth of unity, but I cannot see through my branches how much longer until I touch the sky. She reminds me how far I have come, reaching and stretching and seeking from the ground up, and I recognize the light of God in me when I look through her eyes. You are a goddamn truth. Okay. So we're gonna do these. I don't really know
what happens in these poems. I was going to do a whole series, and I often get really good ideas and then get bored, and so then they happen. But through like some bizarre foray to this like vampire. Okay, so it was called the Desperation series, and it's not worth explaining because it didn't happen. Anyway, this is the 104 of the, yeah. Okay, I danced to the tune of rain as long as no one was looking. I ran until I was blind, until the dirt under my feet cried for me. I second-guessed every footfall between here and escape. Thorns sliced my feet into chaos. My roots ran deep, but the hill was too steep to hold me. With knuckles as wide as seafoam, I fell back into a cavern of needles and smoke, but it doesn't matter now because here the suns are so close I can touch them. They burn holes through my body so he can see right through me. A trial run of authenticity, a week of ocean song began to settle me. Honesty is the doorway I walk through, the path I'm on. He is just another thing I'll have to let go of eventually. The rain I dance to is dancing for me now, and at his beck, I stand waist deep against the ocean. The salt stains my bloody feet, and it's now or never, because that's all we have. The wind carries my troubles away. Arms out wide, I fall one more time and surrender to the current.
Yeah.
I have to, it's over here, I wasn't going to do it. You know how it is, you get up there and everything changes and you feel a thing and it goes a different direction.
Everyone has a plan until we get hit.
Exactly. Where's my
book? Which one?
Is it up there?
The old one?
Yeah.
No,
oh, it's right here. Okay. So I was thinking about Barbie, this chick at work, and Kathleen, who is the... who was making fun of her. And I don't understand. Like, what is the big deal? I just don't understand what the big deal is with trans people. And I wrote, this was like my signature poem for the longest time. I actually got to perform it in Boston. And it was for a trans woman, Black trans woman who was murdered of all days on March 28th, National Women's Day, in 2011. Her name was Markel Camaro Ty. It's called Catalyst in Memoriam. Markel was only 25. On the morning of March 8th, between the hours of 2 and 5 a.m., they shot her. Twice, dragged her body down the highway under their car and dumped her on the side of the road. And even in her death, the media didn't have the decency to grant her the less dignity of using the correct pronouns. A man wearing women's clothing was found dead, they said, as if she had it coming, for daring to be different in a way that made people so uncomfortable. I watched the sheriff hold her at arm's length between phobic fingertips. His face said that the rancid stench of her sunrise rotted flesh was the epitome of everything wrong with the world. And as I cried for my sister, my roommate had the ignorance to tell me not to take it personally. After all, people are murdered every day. Well, maybe if she were murdered for being a mundane, whitewashed suburbanite, people would pay attention. Sometimes I swear, no one but us gives a fuck. It could have been me, and she was one of mine, so damn right I'm gonna take it personally. Every time we lose another, I can't fathom why we're not rioting. I once knew a girl who would name all the lobsters in the tank at a seafood restaurant, so I couldn't eat any of them. Would it help if I brought you a list of the victims? Dino Huwatsi, 28. Stabbed to death and left in a roadside dump. Amanda Gonzalez, strangled. an unidentified transgender woman, body never claimed, was dismembered and mutilated. Another burnt, beheaded. Brenda burned to death. Selma drowned. 16-month-old Roy Antonio Jones III of Southampton, New York, was beaten to death by his mother's boyfriend, who told the cops he was just trying to make him act more like a man instead of a little girl. How many more have to die before we wake up? Well, I am here to tell you that I have had enough. Yes, I will continue to jump down your throats every time you utter the words tranny, faggot, or that's so gay. Because that is where it starts and this is where it ends. I feel the blood in my veins being replaced by gasoline, and that is the righteous indignation we need to take to the streets. If ever there was a time to take a stand, it was the morning of March 8th. Between the hours of 2 and 5 a.m., Markel, I am so sorry. Let's not let it happen again.